Good morning, Huntington Chapel. Good morning. And those who are joining online. The Lord has blessed us with another day to worship Him.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
We're in the full swing of summer. And, you know, yesterday I had the privilege of celebrating a graduation. But what I really took away from yesterday was the blessing of children. Those little ones that Jesus said, do not hamper them from coming to me. There was several boys that were out in the yard investigating things. And I said, let me go see what they're up to. And I had the privilege of letting those little boys tell me about the spiders and all the creepy things that were in the woods. And then they said, let us go up there. It was a treehouse. And one of them scampered right up, but the other two, they weren't too sure. So I helped them up, and they got to explore. And that's what our Father in Heaven wants us to do. He wants us to explore the goodness of our God. And in this book is the only truth. It contains all the wisdom that we need for this life. I'd like to read from Proverbs. Proverbs 1. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel, for obtaining wisdom and discipline, for understanding words of insight, for acquiring a disciplined and a prudent life, doing what is right and just and fair, for giving prudence to the simple and knowledge and discretion to the young. Let the wise listen and add to their learning, and let the discerning and guidance for understanding proverbs and parables and the sayings and the riddles of the wise. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and discipline. Please stand with me as we open our service in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to come together and to worship our Heavenly Father, whom every good and perfect gift comes from the heavenly lights. Lord, we ask that you be with us. We ask that you open our hearts, open our mouths, that praise and worship would come forth. Touch our hearts, O God, as we enter into your presence. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah.
this situation. Worship. Let him reign in your joy and in your sorrows.
Alleluia. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Amen. Oh, dear Lord and Heavenly Father, thank you for the way that you love us so much that you sent your Son from heaven, and he came and he put on flesh and he dwelt amongst us. And he lived a perfect, holy life. And Lord, he paid our debt. He died. But Lord, he rose again. And he reigns with you. And we thank you for worthy is the Lamb. And we just declare your praise. And Lord God, we ask that you would reign in our hearts, reign in our lives. Lord, that you would be glorified. Lord, that we would behold your glory and your holiness. Lord, that we would feel you amongst us this day, Lord, right now. We praise your holy name.
Up.
Jesus' name. And I just want to give everyone a reminder, the word wait doesn't mean to be passive. It doesn't mean don't do anything. It means to prepare for the coming move of your God. There's sometimes there's things that he can move, but there's the things that we need to move out of our lives. And that is waiting upon the Lord is listening, hearing, and then moving, getting ready for his coming move. Not just waiting for him to show up. Because we're not waiting for him. He's waiting for us. So then I praise his name and for the joy we have in coming and waiting upon him now and getting things ready in our lives. And worship is one of the ways that we push things out to get ready for him to come. Hallelujah. How great is our God. To the heavens, your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Hallelujah. Everyone just please have a seat. We're just going to continue we're going to come and present our tithes or offerings to the Lord. After the service, you can just put your tithes and offerings in the offering plate, or you can give online at thehuntingtonchapel.com. But what a blessing we have as we receive blessing to give blessing. And he has been so very good. Life is not easy, but it's good. And I praise the Lord because, you know, when those tough times come, it's just really important to remember, he reigns. Don't take matters in your own hand. Leave it in his hands and follow him. But let's come and present our offering to him in our heart. So, dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for your favor. We thank you for the doors of opportunity that you have given to us. We thank you, Lord, for the way that your spirit leads us and for the way that your favor rests upon us and defines us, that we are more than conquerors. Lord, that you didn't call us to be passive, but Lord, you called us to be active and to live. And dear Lord and Father, we thank you, Lord, that in our living, Lord, you've blessed us with wealth. You've blessed us, Lord, with so many blessings. And we come before you now to give you the first fruit of our efforts, of our love, Lord, of what we cherish. But Lord, we cherish you more. So Lord, we come, we present them to you. Lord, we pray that they would be pleasing in your sight, that you would receive them. And Lord, that we would worship you in spirit and in truth. And Lord, that you would be glorified and that you would build your kingdom. Lord God, I thank you for your presence that is here with us right now. And Lord, that we don't leave your presence here when we leave today. But Lord, that we would bring you with us wherever we go. And Lord, as we do that, Lord, even more favor will be upon us. And we thank you, Lord, for the amazing power of your love. And Lord, how it softens, Lord, so many things. So Lord, we come and we lift you up and we praise you. Lord, receive our tithes and our offerings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. We praise God for his love and his favor. We also praise God for AC, air conditioning. It has broken down this past week, and sometimes we forget. You know, it's like, wow, how did people do church in the past without AC? I don't know. But so hopefully, I know parts are on order, and praise God, it's all under warranty. Right now, the AC is going, but we have to have a hose going on the condenser so it doesn't freeze, and so it thaws it out, but hopefully we'll have that soon. But the plan is that ministry continues this week, and Monday night is going to be High Ground Ministry. Tuesday night will be the Woman's Bible Study. Wednesday night, we have the midweek service at 7, and Thursday is the youth ministry starting at 6. Saturday is the men's fellowship. And Steve, when are we looking to put up the tent? We got to put up our tent out here. Saturday. We're going to do it. So if you could come Saturday, we're going to be doing that at 10:30 thereabouts, and to get that set for the camp that's coming up for Venture Scouts. And just a reminder, and also on next Sunday, we're going to be having those who are serving at Royal Family Kids Camp. And it's awesome. It's a great camp. It's a camp for foster kids that they go away for a week. And for many of these kids, this is the best week out of their entire year. Because we go with a message that God loves them, that they are not a mistake, they're not a failure, they're not a regret, they're not a hardship, but they are fearfully and wonderfully made. And that God, he is the father to the fatherless. And there's a lot of fatherless children in this world. And they need to know that God wants them to be part of his royal family. And to bring them in, to give them his identity, and to give them strength. And what a privilege to love on these kids. And you know, sometimes from what they've been through, it's not easy to love on them. And it's not easy for them to receive it. But through the years, many have. And we praise God for this. And then also, next Monday starts the Venture Day Camp that's going to be here. And just a reminder, although you are a member here and you're welcome here any time, but during the day, for the next for the next 2 weeks, you're not able to come in and just help yourself. We need to respect the security measures that we need to have for the kids, for the camp, and all that. So you can come if you have an appointment with me. You come and go in my office, but we don't just mingle around the property. And I thank you for your respect and receiving that. And one other thing that I do praise God for. I love how God has divine timing. And I don't know about you, but I've heard so many different reports of the schools and different teachings that are going on, and it terrifies me. You know, and as Christians, we need to take a stand. And we need to have representation. And we also, but we need to do it in love. not in righteous indignation, but in the power of love, but to come. And I also just praise God. And right now I'm going to have Steve come on up and introduce a special guest that we have and the ministry that God has put him in on his heart and his fiance's heart. So, Steve, if you would just...
Good morning again. God has awesome things in store for us. And one of the greatest joys that we have is one another and helping one another in this path, in this journey to our Father and King. I've had the pleasure of knowing Chandler. Chandler, if you would just come up and stand beside me while I introduce you. Chandler was on the Shelton High School wrestling team with my son, and I got a chance to watch these guys grow. And the Lord had something very special for Chandler, and I'll let him tell that part of the story. But we have opportunities to partner with young people. Just look around this room. God has provided young people in this room that he has touched and that we're to come alongside and encourage them. So I would like to read from the last paragraph from the Gospel of Matthew. It says, "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age.'" Chandler, it's my privilege to introduce you to the Huntington Chapel.
Thank you very much. All right. Can you hear me okay? Awesome. Well, thank you so much for having me and letting me be with you guys. And like Steve said, my name is Chandler, and I'm excited to be here to share briefly about what God has done in my life and what he has led my fiance Allie and I into this next year with Crew, and which was also known as Campus Crusade for Christ, and they changed their name. You might know that organization. Allie currently is in New Hampshire, deep in wedding planning, because we're getting married in 2 weeks from today. Yeah. She wishes she could be here, but she wishes she could be here this morning, but I'm happy to share for both of us. So, like Steve said, I grew up in Shelton my whole childhood, and I attended Sunday classes, church classes, when I was younger, and heard about Jesus Christ being the Son of God, took away the sins of the world, but I didn't have a relationship with God. And as I progressed through my adolescent years, I really didn't want much to do with God at all. I went through high school, into college, and not thinking about him, not living my life in a way that's pleasing to him. And but then in my sophomore year of college, one of my friends invited me to a Christian club called Crew. And he did it in a very polite way, and I responded, and I was like, "Oh, that's nice," but I rejected the invitation, no thank you. And then that next weekend, I went home and went through a series of traumatic personal experiences, and during that time, God convicted me of my sin and my works, and that I deserved death and punishment, and during that week, I remembered what I heard about Jesus Christ, and I accepted him as my Lord, my Savior. I'm living for him now. Yeah. Yeah. Eventually, I got back to my college campus and shortly after that, I joined the Christian Club crew. And as we were, me and Allie were new Christians, we both became Christians in college. Crew played an instrumental role in our spiritual growth. And while we were in crew, we started meeting regularly with crew staff members who taught us more about the gospel, helped us to read through scripture, and encouraged us and guided us in how to live for Christ in a godly way. And so cool. Even early on in my faith, because of crew, I was able to learn how to share my faith with other students in my dorms, in my classes, and just get the good news out. So good. So I graduated from University of New Hampshire this May, and Allie graduated last year. Yep. Yeah, awesome. And Allie and I are ready to be working with crew. Allie was working with crew last year. She did campus ministry last year, and we'll both be doing the ministry this upcoming year as our full-time jobs. And as Allie and I see, there's so many students at the campus that were in the same place we were when we first started college. There's 15,000 students at the University of New Hampshire, and so many of them do not have a relationship with Christ. And so the harvest is truly plentiful. And God has put a burden on our hearts to introduce people to Christ, help them grow in their faith, and then send them off to be lifelong laborers for Christ. Yeah. And so our desire is, as we're captivated by Christ and dependent upon the Holy Spirit, that our lives would be changed and that the gospel would be made known to all of UNH and all of the world. And so this pandemic has presented a variety of challenges for us in the ministry this past year, but we saw God's faithfulness and power as we continued to pursue students and work in spite of the limitations we faced. Even without being able to do our normal large outreaches and connecting with students, we still saw 20 freshman students connect with the ministry right in the first month of this year, which is awesome.
Amen.
Yeah. And we saw the guys' community flourishing, and that was partly because of the students starting to pray. They started praying Monday through Friday for the campus, which was just so awesome. So this upcoming year, what we're excited about, we're so excited to devote our time to loving and serving the students at the University of New Hampshire. Allie and I's main focus will be connecting with incoming freshmen, discipling students, working with students in the leadership team and directing the ministry, and helping other aspects of the ministry. So let's see. Yeah, so UNH is planning to have less restrictions this upcoming year, which is going to be great, and we're excited to be doing more with the campus ministry. So we are excited because we have the opportunity to invite you to partner with us in reaching students for Christ. We're currently building a team of ministry partners to support us prayerfully and financially before we can return to campus. And we wanted to emphasize how important your prayer support is as we step onto campus. We will be sending out monthly prayer letters of updating how the ministry goes, and we're also seeking financial partnership. Like many other mission organizations, crew is dependent upon the financial support of concerned individuals and churches. And the support we raise this summer will fund our salary and ministry expenses for this upcoming year. As soon as we're fully funded, we can be on campus reaching students for Christ. Right now, we're 80% funded. Yeah, it's awesome. And our goal is to be fully funded before we get married in 2 weeks. Yeah, yeah. So you're probably wondering how you can partner with us. We want to invite you to pray and ask God if he would have you partner with us. This week, we're looking for 10 people to partner with us at a monthly amount of $100 or some other amount that's significant to you. And if you're interested in partnering with us and want to talk to me more, I'd love to set up a time to talk with you. And our information is on the slide, and there's also cards on your seats that you might have seen. I'll put more in the back if you didn't get to get one. So thank you so much for having me and letting me talk and taking the time to listen. We look forward to talking with you more. Thanks so much.
Wait, 1 minute. Let me just put a hand of blessing to Chandler. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, oh Lord God, so many people have gone to church, but they never encountered you. Lord God, I thank you for the way that those seeds that were planted, Lord, they weren't planted in vain. But Lord, how you got Chandler's attention. And Lord God, I thank you, Lord, for the way that your spirit is within him. And Lord, that you would go before him and his soon-to-be wife. Lord, that you would unite them, Lord, in Lord, that they would first know that that you are their grand pursuit. And then, Lord, to pursue each other. And Lord, then, Lord, to be your servants. And Lord God, I pray that you would give them eyes to see the broken. That your spirit would lead them. And Lord, that they would be obedient to your spirit, Lord, when you say, hey, go pray for this person. Go let them know that I love them. Go give them encouragement. And Lord God, that you would go before them. And Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you fitted them, Lord, with a new armor. But Lord, we thank you for the gospel of peace that are on their feet. Lord, that everywhere they step, Lord, I pray, Lord, that they would be bold, that they would be encouraged. Lord, they would be bold and courageous. They would not be terrified. They would not be discouraged. But Lord, that they would lean on you. And Lord, that your favor would be with them. Lord, as you want to communicate your amazing love for the lost, Lord, for all humanity. Lord, your desire that no one would perish, but that all would come. But Lord God, I pray, Lord, that you would be with Chandler and his wife, Lord, in the spiritual battle, as, Lord, in so many colleges, the darkness prevails. But Lord, we thank you, Lord, that light has come into the darkness, and the darkness shall not overcome it. May they shine, oh Lord, Lord, in spiritual ways that they have never anticipated. And may your favor be upon them and go before them. And we just bless them now. And Lord, bless their marriage. Bless, oh Lord God, the day that's coming when you unite them as two. And Lord God, we just thank you, Lord, for the gift, Lord, and for the way that you're equipping them. Be with them now, Lord, and bless them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Pleasure, buddy. God bless you. Let's stand for our closing song. Amen.
Only over.
won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up coming after me.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down
coming after me. All the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Hallelujah.
Oh, dear Lord and Heavenly Father, thank you for the way that you wrap your loving arms around us. Thank you for the way that you restore our strength, for the hope that you bring into our lives, for the power to overcome. We thank you, Lord, for the way that your love, Lord, changes everything. Lord, come and change us now in the fullness of your love. Oh, Lord, that we'd be transformed by the renewing of our mind, that we would know your good, pleasing, and perfect will, and we would do it for you, oh, Lord, for you are worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This time we'd like to have our kids head off to kids' church, have fun in the Lord. Everyone, please be seated as we just praise the Lord as the Lord brings the message this morning through our brother Juwan.
Amen. Praise God. Let's keep that mindset of worship. Come on, let's give God a 20-second praise. Hallelujah. Glory, God. We praise you. We magnify you. We give you glory in this house because you're worthy of it. We don't need to feel like it. We just need to know that we need it. When we praise God, there is a release that happens in us and around us. We need worship. It is a continual place that we need to live. Amen. I bless you, brother, for what you're doing. Your ministry is so important. For every young adult in this room, know that you are the bridge. You are the bridge between the old and the new. You speak two languages. You speak the language of the old school, and you speak the language of the new school. And you are the role models to the ones who just walked out of this room. And the enemy's going to try to come after you, because if he can get you, then he can get them. But the devil is a liar, because God has placed in you a power, brother, a power. You want to know what your power is, brother? It's your humility. And you remain in that humbleness as you go up there and you war for Christ. And in the most difficult times, you remember that he who has sent you will be with you through it all. And don't ever forget that. In Jesus' name. We're going to start today with, we're going to open basically with Mark. We're going to start at chapter 1. And we're going to read through verse 21 to 38. I was told that I drink a lot of water when I'm up here. Yeah, I get cotton mouth. I think it's God's way of keeping me from talking too much. Amen. We need to listen more than we talk. You know that, right? The mouth needs the ears to talk. The ears don't need the mouth to listen. Let's read. Mark chapter 1, verse 21 to 38. Then they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his teaching. For he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Now there was a man in the synagogue who with an unclean spirit, and he cried out saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Look at that really quickly, how the unclean spirit says, "Let us alone. What do we have to do with you?" And then he says, "I know who you are." So we know that they travel in many. But the spokesman, the strong man, said, "I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be quiet and come out of him." How many know that Jesus wasn't exactly polite to unclean spirits? And when the unclean spirit had convulsed him and cried out with a loud voice, he came out of him. Then they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority he commands even unclean spirits, What is this? What new doctrine? For with authority he commands all unclean spirits. They obey him, and immediately his fame spread throughout the region around Galilee. Now, soon as they had come out of the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. But Simon's wife's mother lay sick with a fever. And they told him about her at once. So he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. And immediately the fever left, and she served them. At evening, when the sun had set, they brought to him all who were sick and those who were demon-possessed, and the whole city was gathered together at the door. Then he healed many who were sick with various diseases, cast out many demons, and he did not allow the demons to speak because they knew him. Now, in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place. Everyone say solitary place. And there he prayed, and Simon and those who were with him searched for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." But he said to them, "Let us go into the next town, that I may preach there also, because for this purpose I have come forth." Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you glory, God, because you are worthy of it. And we ask you to bless this here, your word, and we pray, Spirit, Holy Spirit, that you're able to make your message clear and complete, that we may understand. And Father, we ask you to be with our hearts today as we dive into this just for a short while. And we say this in Jesus' name. Thank you. Amen. I love the Apostles Mark's depiction of this awesome passage. Mark emphasizes actions and deeds. Jesus is constantly on the go, healing people and casting out demons, performing miracles, hurrying from place to place and teaching. In Mark, everything happens immediately. As soon as one thing ends, another begins. However, the rapid pace slows down when Jesus enters Jerusalem that we see in chapter 11, verse 1. Thereafter, events are marked by days, and his final days by hours. Jesus did not get much rest after the previous evening's activities, which were many. Can you imagine being in that moment? Once again, it's one thing to read this, but just imagine. He goes into the temple. He begins to teach. Everyone is blessed and amazed by what he is teaching. Then someone just starts to yell out of the congregation at him. He then casts out the unclean spirit. Then they walk. We don't know how long this took, but they walk and they enter into Simon's mother-in-law's in the house, and she's not feeling well. Then he heals her. Then he goes to the door. Now we're in the evening now. He goes to the door, and the scripture says the entire city is at the door. Are we grasping this? The entire city is at the door. Imagine if we open the door and the entire city of Shelton is at the door. People who are lamed and bullet wounds, right, in our day and time. But back then, people being stabbed, people who are having heart attacks, people who are sick, people who are lepered. There was all these different people with all these different issues, and it was an entire city of people. And Jesus healed them all. The title of today's message is After the Work is Done, Rest. Amen? Rest. I wanted to discuss 3 points on this morning, but I believe the Spirit only wanted me to focus on one. And that is, ladies and gentlemen, rest in the Spirit. Matthew chapter 11, verse 25 to 30 says, "At this time, Jesus answered and said, 'I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have these things from the wise and prudent, that you hidden these things from the wise and prudent, and have revealed them to babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in your sight, all things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find your rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. What does this mean to you? Many of Christians have read this passage many times, yet don't apply it. Why? Because I believe we don't exactly understand it, what Jesus is saying here. I like to read scripture in different versions. I strongly encourage that. But every now and again, I look at the Message version. Now, I wouldn't encourage necessarily studying from the Message version or using that as your primary Bible. But every now and again, the Message kind of brings a little clarity. And I want to read that from the Message version. I think it's up there. But from the Message, abruptly, Jesus broke into prayer. Thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. You've concealed your ways from the sophisticated and know-it-alls, but spelled them out clearly to ordinary people. Yes, Father, that's the way you like to work. Jesus resumed talking to the people, but now tenderly. The Father has given me all these things to do and say. This is a unique Father-Son operation, coming out of the Father and Son intimacies and knowledge. No one knows the Son the way the Father does, nor the Father the way the Son does, but I'm not keeping it to myself. I'm ready to go over it line by line with anyone willing to listen. Are you tired? Worn out? Burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take real rest. Walk with me. Work with me. Watch me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Amen. This passage is not about Jesus making your life easier. It's not about Jesus taking away your problems and making everything comfortable for you. This is an invitation to do life with him. He is asking you on a date that does not end ever. This is where Jesus wants us to be. In Mark 35, verse 40, this is where Jesus wants us to be. Here. On the same day, when evening has come, he said to them, "Let us cross to the other side." Now, when they had left the multitude, they took him along. When they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was. And other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose. I want you guys to have a visual. Picture this in your mind. A great windstorm had arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care? We are perishing." Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the sea and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" This is a mental place. This is the mental place that Jesus is driving us to. Undisturbed peace. I do not believe Jesus was upset because they were afraid of the storm. I believe he was really bothered because they actually thought that the boat was going to go down with him in it. You literally However, many of us find ourselves there. The difference between them and us is that we have the Holy Spirit and they haven't had it at the time. True rest for our souls can only be found in Jesus Christ. Spiritual rest is, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. The scripture aforementioned will only benefit us if Jesus is our everyday and not just our once in a while or when times get rough. He cannot be just the appetizer. He cannot be just the main course, and he cannot be just the dessert. He must be the appetizer, main course, and the dessert. He must be everything. Resting in the spirit will allow you to properly also rest in the natural. There are many of us who struggle in the area of rest and sleep. The enemy works very hard to rob us of our sleep and peace of mind. Do you know it is God's will for you to rest both in the spirit and in the natural? But if the enemy can get us so tired, so exhausted, that we don't have time for each other, and we don't even have the strength to fight off the problems that we face day to day. This begins, guys, with us resting in the Spirit, resting with him, meditating on his word day and night, going on that date with Jesus. This is something that our culture, our world, is constantly trying to take us away from. I want to do something real quick as I feel the Spirit is leading. I'm going to ask everybody to close their eyes. And Lara, I'm going to ask you if you can come up. Yeah, absolutely. Everybody keep their eyes closed but Lara. I don't want you to trust me right now. I want you to trust Jesus. And I just want you to really just keep your eyes closed. I want you to imagine that you are sitting in a room and you are sitting on the most comfortable chair possible. And the Father's about to come in the room to speak with you one-on-one. Face to face. And now he's in front of you. And there's a cool breeze that just comes over you. And you just feel such a relaxation. No worry, no expectation. Nothing to prove to anybody. Just you. And him. And all that you have gone through, every pain, every burden, every weight, frustrations. Some of you in here right now are so burdened for your children. Some of you in here are battling with anxiety that goes just beyond and has taken too much of your time and has robbed you. But God wants to impart peace to you right now. He wants to remove fear of the future. Receive this into your spirit as I am saying this to you through the Spirit of God. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are his masterpiece. You were not by accident, but you were intentional and on purpose. For the Lord, your God, your Father, loves you. He says, I love you. I love you, daughter. I love you, son. Will you receive my love today? Proverbs 3, verse 24. When you lie down, you will not be afraid. Yes, you will lie down and your sleep will be sweet. Psalm 35:3, verse 5. I lay down and I slept. I awoke, for the Lord sustained me. I rebuke all insomnia off of everyone who is battling this in this room in Jesus' name. I cancel the assignment of your sleep being robbed of you every night in Jesus' name. By the authority of Jesus Christ, I cancel every assignment of nightmares in people right now in Jesus' name. There are some people in here dealing with sleep apnea, but there is one of you in here, the Spirit is telling me, that the sleep apnea has been so bad that not even a machine has been able to help you. And I'm hearing in the Spirit, I don't know who you are, but I'm hearing in the Spirit that you have not been able to sleep, not in weeks, months, but years. And Father, in the name of Jesus, I don't know who this is, but I lay my hand on them in the Spirit right now, and I cancel that assignment in Jesus' name. They will have a peaceful night's sleep. They will rest. They will rest. But the Spirit of the Lord is telling you right now, slow down your mind. You're thinking too much. And you're thinking so much that even when you close your eyes to sleep, you're still thinking. You're not actually asleep, you're awake. But right now, I release to you the rest of the Holy Spirit, that rest that Jesus had when he was in the boat. Receive it today and sleep in peace. And wake up refreshed and renewed. And lastly, the enemy has been able to use our minds as a playground because of the lack of rest. But rest will allow you to do this. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when obedience is fulfilled. In the Spirit, God is releasing today a supernatural peace over your mind as you come into obedience to him, as you agree with him right now that you will rest with him, that you will do life with him, that you will make time for him, that as you are beginning to practice these things, that you will begin to see your mind working in a different way, and that your mind will no longer be a playground for the enemy. You will no longer battle frustration and anger and rage and depression and anxiety and oppression and heaviness and fear and doubt and faith. For the peace of God keeps us from all these things. Undisturbed peace. Problems does not necessarily mean that we're not in the rightful place with God. For they were going through a storm, but yet Jesus slept. Chaos is evidence. Chaos is evidence of things being out of order. It's evidence of confusion. Going through a storm with chaos and confusion, I would evaluate where you're at with God. But when you're going through a storm, but yet you have your peace, you might be in the place that God wants you to be. Because when you come out of the storm, you will come out differently from the way that you went in. Guys, today wasn't about me preaching a normal message. Today was about an impartation that Jesus Christ wants to give everyone this morning. He wants to give you authentic rest, not just for your mind, but for your soul. So that you may walk in the calling that he has assigned for you. But for some, even to even tap into that place, a decision has to be made. See, Jesus came and he died. And when he died, he paid an ultimate sacrifice. And he rose. And when he rose, we became free from all the things that we are subjected to right now. And Jesus the Christ says that I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, and no one shall get to the Father except by me. So all that I'm speaking now only applies if you've done that. Many people say, I believe, but do you believe in your heart? I told you guys my testimony a while ago that I was in my dining room on the floor when I cried out to God and I said, if you do not do something, I don't know what I'm going to do. In 24 hours, my life was different. I gave my life to Jesus between me and him in the dining room of my house. However, 24 hours later, he led me to this church in Trumbull called New Life. And I sat in New Life all the way in the back of the sanctuary. And I'm sitting there, and this church is long. And as I'm sitting there, Pastor Evans, the father, says this: there is someone in here who just gave his life to God, but he needs to publicly do it. My heart started to beat at 100 miles an hour. Because he said I had to come up. And I'm like, why do I have to come up? Why can't I just sit here and do it? And the Spirit recently told me, because if you can't come out in public and confess who I am, then what's going to keep you with me? So I put this out there. Some of you might have said in your mind, I believe you, Jesus. You might even set it in a chair when somebody called it out and told you to raise their hand and said, pray with me. But I'm telling you this morning, Jesus is saying, If you truly want it to be over, if you truly want things to be different, you have to start doing things different. And I need you to step out beyond yourself, step out beyond your fear, and I need you to show me you love me. So the altar is right here, and I'm asking you to do something bold and courageous, but I guarantee you, if you do this for him, he will do miraculous things for you starting today in the name of Jesus. That might be you, and if that is you, everybody's eyes is closed. It's not about looking at you. It's not about how you look. It's about the host of heaven right now that's sitting and waiting to chair as you come up here right now. I'm asking you to be bold and courageous. If you know that you need to confess, that you need to publicly acknowledge that Jesus Christ is your Lord, that he is your Savior, I'm asking you to come up here right now. I'm asking you to come up here right now. Come on, come on. Do not be afraid. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, church. Come on, church. Come on, church. We need to be excited. We need to be excited. We need to be excited. For this is what it's all about. This is what it's about. If this ain't happening, it's not church. We're not here just to have a social club. We're here because Jesus loves them and loves us. And this was us at one time. But I know it's not done. I know it's not done. Don't be afraid. You might have said, okay, I already did that, Juwan. But I'll say this to you. If you did do that, but now you find yourself in a bewildered place. You said, Juwan, yes, I started off great, but something happened in the middle of it. But now I find myself in a place where I'm not quite where I need to be with God. But I want to get back to that place with God. I want to rest in the Spirit. If that is you, you need to come on up here now. You need to come on. Come on now. Hallelujah. Come on, church. Be excited. Be excited. Be excited. Be excited. Be excited. I want to tell you what's happening today. This is breakthrough. And the reason why it's breakthrough is because God has broken them. And now they're at a place where they've made a solid decision. I choose the rest of God. And this is where it begins. And I want to tell you why. Because the next 5 minutes is not promised to us. Who told anybody in this room they were making it home today? And I'm going to tell you right now. It's grace and mercy now, but when we close our eyes, it's no more grace and mercy, it's judgment. When you close your eyes for the final time in this world, you will open your eyes in another world. And whatever you see when you open your eyes, that is your eternity. This is not a game. This is about a life, and we only get one. And Jesus did not give us that life just for us to lollygag. We have work to do, people. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. I'm going to ask you all to close your eyes. And I want you to repeat after me. And I'm only asking you to repeat after me, not because I believe you can't pray, but I believe God has assigned me this morning to walk you through the process. For those of you who are doing this for the first time, the word says that if you believe in your heart and confess out of your mouth, and today you being up here means that you believe in your heart, And for those of you who already did this, but now find yourself in a bewildered place, you being up here, you're publicly saying, Jesus, I want to be back in your perfect rest. And whoever that was I was speaking about the sleep apnea, is up here right now. And God says there's going to be a divine, miraculous healing that's going to come to you because of your faithfulness. So repeat after me, Father. Repeat after me, Father. In the name of Jesus, I thank you. I honor you. And I pray that my action today will be worship, a sweet aroma to your nostrils. Today, I declare and I proclaim that I am yours. I submit my will. I submit my desires to you. I renounce fear, oppression. I renounce anxiety and worry and doubt and fear of the future. I give you my mind. I give you my heart. Come into me. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Teach me how to live like you. May I be pleasing to you in every way. And may the love that you give me today, I give it out generously. Now I'm going to say this to you. In the name of Jesus, by the authority of the Holy Spirit, I break every generational curse. I break everything that has come against your mind. I break everything that has tried to come against your relationships, that has tried to destroy your marriages, that has tried to destroy your relationships with your children, that has tried to come against your mind. I break that those sleepless nights where you can't sleep because you are so heavy and stressed out. I come against every demonic, satanic attack against your life in Jesus' name. That spirit that has tried to keep your loved ones from coming into the obedience of Christ, I cancel that now in Jesus' name. And what you're doing today, I pray that the spirit will begin to work on those who you love. And we declare it now. We believe it. I anoint you in the name of Jesus, and I mark you for the service of Christ. And from this day forward, you will walk in power. You will walk in authority. You will be all that Jesus has called you to be. You will walk in humility. And even when you go through, you will not give up. You will persevere. You will endure. You are an olive, and an olive must be pressed. And from that pressing comes the oil, and the oil is the anointing. But then it must be preserved. The frankincense and the myrrh and the lavender will be that thing that causes you to be preserved. And that preserving is the word of God. I pray that the word of God will open up to you the minute that you read it, and that you will desire it greatly. So, Father, I thank you and I praise you. Today has been a great day in the kingdom. And all the church say, amen. Hallelujah. Let's give them a praise.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Ah. Amen. We're going to just continue here. We're going to come and to have our closing song. But it's not our closing worship, because our whole life is worship. And everything that we do. And I praise one of the greatest verses, I think. And Jesus says, all of the law and prophets are this: to love the Lord your God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. You can't love him with all your strength until you give him everything else. And as he comes, and the beautiful thing is, he wants to reveal himself to you. But what he really wants is to reveal you to you. for you to see yourself through his eyes and not through the world's eyes and not through those who know how to speak death, but he wants to speak life. He wants you to come closer. He wants you to find him and to walk with him day by day. So let's stand and let's sing our closing song to our Lord.
Those of you who gave your life today for the first time publicly, please meet with me after service. And there's a young woman in here, the Spirit is telling me, I don't know, I think you come from a line of ministry. I think your parents are ministers, whatever the case. If that is you, I need you to come to me afterwards. I have to speak to you about something. And for those of you who have recommitted yourself to Christ today, know that the battle is not over. That the minute you walk out that door, the spirit of the enemy is going to try to come. The word tells us that because of a lack of knowledge, the enemy was able to steal the word. So I'm letting you know now, when you walk out that door, put that armor on. Walk out that door knowing who you are. Regardless of what the enemy tries to do or tries to say, or when he tries to come, if he does it at work, or he does it once you walk in the door at home, or whatever the case may be, I want you to remember the decision you made today, and this is why he's doing it. But he's only doing it because he's afraid, because he now knows that you are back in position. Amen. Do not leave out of here the same way you came in. For you are his royal priest. Amen.
And it's also powerful because sometimes we do things for God. He doesn't want us to do things for him. He wants us to do things with him. And there's a difference. Don't go alone. He was there. Let him lead you. Jesus doesn't follow. He leads. And he says, come, follow me. So let's do life with Jesus. But we need to be close. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, thank you for the beauty of your outstretched arms. Thank you, Jesus, for the way, Lord, they didn't need to nail your arms to the cross. You put them there. And now, Lord, you put them around us. Oh, Lord God, I pray right now for a supernatural exchange from heaven. Oh, Lord, how you have loved, how you have longed for us to come into your embrace for such a long time. But Lord, sometimes we are too stubborn. And we want to prove that we don't need you. But we keep just proving, Lord, that we need you more than anything. And Lord, so we come before you right now. Lord, breathe the breath of fresh air, a breath of your fresh spirit within us. Oh, Lord, that we would breathe you in, that you would come and sustain us. Fill us, oh, Lord. Oh, Lord God, change the way we see things. Change, Lord, that, Lord, bring that transformation of our mind. Oh, Lord God, to the great adventure that lays before us. And, Lord, that we will follow you with every step. So be with us now, oh, Lord. And guide us, Lord, in our time with you. And Lord, so that you will equip us to walk through this world with you for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Walk with your King and be his blessing. God bless you all.